So Jonathan Barnett's study, which I thought was very well done and quite extensive, is all documented by FEMA in Appendix C in their BPAT report that was May of 2002. Unfortunately, it was never used in the NIST report, and it wasn't really used in the explanation for how the buildings fell in the FEMA report either. So it seems that although the report was done, and it was very well done, it was never really used by the report to explain or should I say that the questions that they brought up in that report, which are, how do you get that much, where did the sulfur come from? How much sulfur do you need to create these phases? And how do you get the temperatures required to create the phases? I believe in the report, they put a minimum temperature of 940 degrees C to create the phases, and that's at the eutectic. So those questions were never addressed by either the report or either by Jonathan Barnett's report or by the FEMA report itself or by the NIST report. These questions were never addressed. And I think they're significant because you've got this evidence here. How do you get those temperatures? Where do you get the sulfur? These are things that we should be asking and people should be investigating. So around in 2006, Steve Jones was working on some other evidence that he had acquired, which was dust evidence. And one of the things that he was doing was going through that dust and with a magnet and finding spheres, microspheres, whatever you want to call them, and looking at those spheres and trying to get the composition of those spheres. It's a difficult task at best to try and determine the composition of these spheres, because in order to get the internal composition, you've got to somehow break these open. And fortunately, he was able to find some that were actually broken open. At this time, Steve was working with a student at Brigham Young University, a BYU student, a physics student, and Daniel Farnsworth is his name. And he and together they were working on the electron microscope and using X-ray analysis to try and determine the chemistry of these microspheres. When Steve told me he was looking through the dust, through these dust samples, I thought this was a fool's errand. I just thought, you know, this is a needle in a haystack. I didn't really think that they'd find anything significant, to be honest. I really didn't. And I was stuck, you know, I mean, I stuck with working on these steel samples, which I thought were significant, and I still do. Eventually, Steve came to me and said, we're finding these red-gray chips. And I really didn't think anything of it. It could have been, they could have been anything. And but he kept, the significant thing about the red-gray chips was not just the frequency in which they were finding them, but also they were attracted by a magnet, and which was his method for pulling out these spheres. And so he was pulling out the spheres as well as the red-gray chips. And so he came to me and said, we're getting some interesting compositional analysis from the red layer of these red-gray chips. We're actually seeing peaks of aluminum, as well as other things. But the aluminum peak was significant because so he'd find these aluminum peaks and as well as iron peaks and oxygen peaks and various other peaks. But the aluminum and the iron and the oxygen together were very significant because this is your composition for thermite. So that's when I started to get a little bit more interested in the dust and get more interested in these red-gray chips. So, but I didn't really start working on these red-gray chips, and Steve and Daniel were continuing to find things about the chips, and they would bring that information to me. And eventually I said, okay, I remember we were sitting in my office and he was talking about the red-gray chips. And I thought, okay, if you really want to see if these red-gray chips are significant, what we could do is take one of these chips and put it in a calorimeter and see if they're energetic. And at that point, Steve was saying, well, how do we find a calorimeter? Who's got a calorimeter? So I found a lab that had a calorimeter that we could use. It's a DSC, a differential scanning calorimeter. and learned quickly how to use the calorimeter and how to calibrate it and make sure that we were doing everything properly. I actually had somebody that really uses it a lot there with me as I conducted these experiments. And so we put one of the chips, one of the larger chips that we had, into the calorimeter and let it run to see what would happen. And that was really a turning point for the red-gray chips for me, because we got a peak on the calorimeter, which shows that these red-gray chips were energetic. They were putting out more energy, and I mean they were very exothermic. And the width of the peak was also significant, because it showed the power that the chips had. So that was really the turning point for the red-gray chips. And that's when I got very interested in the red-gray chips and joined them in their study of the red-gray chips and really took off with that. So that was, but the significance of the calorimeter cannot be understated here. The calorimeter can't lie to you. If that thing pops off, if you get a sharp peak in the calorimeter, that material is energetic. The degree to it, you know, the degree of its energy is determined by the height of the peak, and the power at which it goes off is the width of the peak. But we were finding very narrow peaks and very high peaks in the calorimeter, which showed that this very, very small chip had a lot of energy packed into it, more than you would find in everyday materials at the office. So and certainly the number of chips that they were finding in these random dust samples made the fact that the fact that they were present there in such quantity also made them significant. So it wasn't an anomaly. It certainly wasn't an anomaly, because we were getting multiple dust samples from multiple individuals who had no connection with each other, had no connection to Steve or myself. And they're sending us these dust samples, and every one of the dust samples was showing red-gray chips, and they were it was striking in their similarity. The paper that we wrote about the red-gray chips, you can actually see we've taken images of these photographs of these red-gray chips to show these things are so similar we couldn't ignore these red-gray chips any longer. And that's where the paper really took off. That's where the data for the paper really took off. Some have speculated that the red-gray chips are just paint. I haven't seen any studies of paint by those that are speculating this. We did our own study of paint in the DSC and found that the paint will eventually burn up and turn to ash, but it certainly doesn't give you an energetic spike in the DSC. So we actually did some experiments to compare the elemental composition of primer paint from the Trade Center steel that was taken off of one of the beams in the Clarkson College beams, but it was taken from one of the beams used in the World Trade Center. And the chemical composition did not match that of the red-gray chips. So we know that it's not the primer paint that was on the steel. So once the chips were ignited in the DSC, we then looked at the residue or the remnant of those chips in the microscope again, and we did find very, very small spheres that were similar to the microspheres that Steve was finding in the dust samples, smaller on average, but still very similar in composition and in look of the microspheres that Steve was finding.